It is with the greatest of pleasures and the deepest of honors to introduce to you this next speaker, Karen Herrick. It's a very special honor for me because she introduced me to this wonderful organization. And if it wasn't for her, I probably wouldn't be in the organization or here or met so many wonderful people and experienced so many wonderful experiences. So again, it's with great pleasure that I'm introducing her. And there's a precious little book I asked you to look through in the bookstore. And Grandma, What is a Soul? And it is not only, there's a section also for adults. Look through it. I'm sure you will want to get some for children, grandchildren, and significant others who haven't caught up to us on our journey. So, Reverend Karen E. Herrick has a PhD in philosophy with specialization in spiritual psychology from the Union Institute and University in Cincinnati. She has a master's degree from Rutgers University Graduate School of Social Work in New Brunswick, New Jersey, specializing in alcohol and drug studies. Karen has shared her clinical expertise for 30 years in her private practice by lecturing throughout the United States on dysfunctional and addictive homes, disassociation, grief, loss from a Jungian perspective. Karen was the first female president of ASCS in 27 years. I'm sorry, 37 years. 37 years. And she is the immediate past president of this organization. She was ordained in the interfaith ministry in 1995. Her ministry is to be actively involved in spiritual psychology, specifically in naming spiritual experiences and working with chronic grief using EMDR techniques. Her first book, You're Not Finished Yet, is available through Amazon.com, AuthorHouse.com, and Kindle. Her second book, which is the one that I held up, is just adorable on many levels. And that's available through Amazon.com, CreateSpace.com, Kindle, and at our bookstore. I'm going to, while she is giving her presentation, pass out two, one on each side. These are sheets asking for your name, email address, and for some of us older folk, snail mail address. So we would appreciate if you would fill these out for Karen also. Without further ado, Ms. Herrick.
Thank you. And I thank you for staying up to hear me. Okay, I'm used to having my computer in front of me, so I'm going to do this. Am I? That's right. There we go. Okay, so first I want to thank two helpers. One's my middle daughter, who lives in Reno, and she does all my illustrations, which I'm sure you'll appreciate. And then Charles Tart, he was one of the founders of transpersonal psychology, which believes in altered states of consciousness. And as I was researching this topic that I'm going to be talking about tonight, I kept seeing him. He either did the foreword or he did chapters, or of course I did read several of his books, but I used him kind of as a good luck sign. If I could see him, then I would read more in that book. I've spent decades in the field of addiction. Carl Jung stated that the alcoholic was looking for spirit, but instead was imbibing spirits. And coming from an alcoholic family, I've spent much of my life looking for spirit. And so today I'm going to give you a better understanding of the mechanics of communication in getting in touch with your soul. And how I got in touch with this, like I always wondered, how does this work, you know, that we get all this information from people like mediums. And I was reading a book, and this was in your, my handout was in your, when you first came. So on there is a book by Michael Newton. And he writes about, he's hypnotizes people, and they tell him where they go between lives. And so this one story kind of touched me of a young man who went, he didn't know where he was, but he said that wherever he was, he went under a soul shower. And it took away all the negativity and a lot of the pain that he had been through in this life. And so I thought about that, and I kept thinking about it. And I thought, well, if he went up there and it erased the memories from down here, what part of him did he take up there? So that's what started me on what I'm going to tell you tonight. So I want you to think about how you would describe your soul and what is the most challenging aspect in regard to your soul. The wings that form the butterfly lie folded in the worm. And this also helped me to realize that when we're born, we have this soul that we don't know anything about. And like the caterpillar that becomes the butterfly, that is our job. Your soul is placed in your unconscious and is composed of energy. This energy forms into feelings, attitudes, value systems, or entire personalities that live inside of you. And if you begin to know your soul, you're going to learn to be more self-reliant. Now, I want you to keep this atomic picture in your mind for this slide and the next slide. And this is nuclear fusion and is a nuclear reaction in which two or more atomic nuclei come very close and then collide at a very high speed and join to form a new type of atomic nucleus. So this is the physical process of the soul. It's how it gets into your body. Your soul is developing in the higher levels of existence, and when the time is right and your body is ready, the soul projects an extension of itself down into the human body and anchors itself through a spiritual process equivalent to atomic fusion. A fiery umbilical of energy is established, called the silver thread, and through this, an extension of self. And then that's how a birth of a spiritual person happens. Now, humans, we're given a mind with an ego. And with an ego, a person can now watch their minds at play. And they may now become aware of being aware. And in psychology, this is called having an observer self. The silver thread or cord is similar to an umbilical cord, which connects the fetus at the navel with the placenta. This cord contains three sections, two umbilical arteries and one vein that transports nourishment to the fetus and removes its waste. The vagus nerve, which I'm going to discuss later, also contains three strands, and the vagus nerve is the silver cord. So that's my news tonight. Now we have a built-in amnesia about our soul, even though it is our highest center of wisdom and perspective. Where is your soul? Well, it's in your unconscious, according to Jung, in the fifth layer. And our unconscious, the definition that we use in psychology, is that it holds your repressed memories. And I want to add that it's also a four-dimensional mind contained in a three-dimensional body. Because if you think about your unconscious as a four-dimensional mind, you'll understand how it helps for you to get for mediums to get information, for us to have intuition, because it's a different dimension in the unconscious, and it's part of you. Now, every religion believes you have a soul, and it's the spirit part of you, and your soul comes to earth to learn. Your story develops your soul. How did you come to be? Who are your parents and your grandparents? And what messages were you given as you were growing up? Now, in Jungian psychology, also Jung believed in genealogy because he believed that we inherited traits and jobs from our ancestors, and even jobs that, especially jobs that they did not finish, and it was our job to finish what they didn't do. Plato said we all know more than we think we know, and this knowledge is contained in our soul. Number one, we chose our parents before we chose, therefore we chose what culture, what country, and what area of the world we will live in. Number two, our lives have themes, and we set goals and we're supposed to follow them through. And what theme did you choose? Maybe you came in to be a parent or a daughter or a son or part of a community. Maybe you came here to take risks and to be a better male or female. What emotions were stirred in you in this family? And what emotions did you hide? What role models did or didn't you have? And how did you learn to express yourself? Or maybe you don't express yourself, and maybe you keep things inside of you. Maybe in this life you're supposed to speak out. So we start our soul journey in a family. And if you're supposed to speak out, what would you be afraid to say? Your soul is integrated by your thoughts. What type of thoughts direct your day? That's very important. Your soul starts in childhood and develops into adulthood, passing through many stages through each life that you have. Developing a conscience is the soul's job. You are here to learn right from wrong. Were you taught to have a connection to God or a higher power as you developed your soul? We usually connect to our soul when we are so-called dead. The soul usually leaves the body out of the top of your head, and something pulls you out of your body. And then your body looks wispy. Leaving your body is like shedding your skin, like peeling a banana. Your body is simply the vehicle that aids in your soul's growth. It's like your car. It gets you places. You have guides, angels, and positive ancestors who help you on your soul's journey. Guides choose you, and no two guides are the same. Two themes we need to deal with on Earth are to be separate and isolated. We come in the world alone, and we leave it alone. It's important to remember that there is an unseen world all around us where spirits are helping us. Perhaps if you don't believe that you have guides or spirits, you could act as if this week and see what happens. Because guides and spirits communicate to us and our loved ones using wireless messages. They have been wireless since the beginning of time. Guides are more parental than dictators. They suggest, they prod, they remind, they send people to do the same. And it's important to wake up and hear and see these signs. Thomas More is a famous Jungian psychologist, and he wrote a book called Care of the Soul. And he knew Joseph Campbell. And Joseph Campbell is famous for the Bill Moyer talks, I think of about 20, 25 years ago. If you ever can see them, they're very good. Anyway, Joseph Campbell's famous for follow your bliss and then you will be happy. The thing is, you have to find out what your bliss is. And before he called it following your bliss, Moore states that he called it follow your weird. And he explained that your weird meant sisters or fates that spin your life and your destiny. So you are to follow your life that has been spun out in front of you. And if you're going to do this, you're going to be a little weirder than the average person. And by being weirder, you gain depth.